Okay, so we are going to start with the practice test. And this is going to be practice test letter A, which says the velocity of the transverse waves produced by an earthquake. I'll go ahead and write this down. So the velocity of the transverse waves produced by the earthquake is 5.1 kilometers per second, while that of the longitudinal waves, so velocity of the longitudinal waves, is 8.67 kilometers per second. And then it says a seismograph records the arrival of the transverse waves 7.3 seconds after that of the longitudinal wave. So we've got a gap in the time. So we can relate the time for the transverse waves to the time for the longitudinal waves. And we know that we've got a time gap of 73 seconds. But the question is, which one takes longer, the transverse or the longitudinal? Let's see. Well, the transverse is the slower of the two waves. So if it's slower, it's going to take longer. So my transverse time should be the longer time. So the time for the transverse is equal to the time for the longitudinal plus the 73 seconds. And we want to double check and make sure that everything's in the same units. So if you look at this, we've got kilometers in seconds, and that time is in seconds. Be careful, it gives it to you in minutes, or something is an oddball unit, make sure that you do the conversion. All right. If you think about what's happening here, you've got the earthquake. There's my earthquake happening. You've got these waves that come from that same point, from that epicenter of the earthquake, and they both end up at the seismometer. So they both end up at the same place. So both of these waves, the T wave and the L wave, the transverse and the longitudinal, they both travel the same distance. So we can say the distance traveled by the transverse is equal to the distance traveled by the longitudinal, and we can use that as our starting point. Also remember, the only real physics equation that we have is that distance is equal to speed times time. And that does work in this case. We are dealing with something that's traveling at a constant speed. These two waves, they could have been cars or people or any two things that are moving at a constant velocity. All right, so the distance that they travel, that's actually what I'm looking for, are those distances. So I don't know these distances, but I can take this kind of simple equation that the two distances are equal and build on that. So I'm going to replace distance with the speed of the transverse times the time of the transverse is equal to the speed of the longitudinal times the time of the longitudinal. And I know what those speeds are, so I know what these two things are. So at this point, my equation has two unknowns in it. However, since I wrote my relationship equation over here for the times, I've got a second equation with the same two unknowns. So I can combine these equations and finish up solving this. So what I'm going to do is substitution method. I know that the time for the transverse wave is equal to the time for the longitudinal plus 73. I'm just going to take that and plug it in over here. So I'm combining these two equations. And when I combine these two equations, I end up with the velocity of the transverse times the time of the longitudinal plus 73 seconds equals the velocity of the longitudinal times the time of the longitudinal. So at that point, the only unknown in this equation would be the time for the longitudinal wave. I'm down to a single equation with a single unknown. So I'm just going to plug in the numbers, do the algebra, and figure out what that time is for that longitudinal. So let's plug in our numbers here. We know that the velocity of the transverse is our 5.1. And then this is going to be the time of the longitudinal plus 73 equals the velocity of the longitudinal, which is our 8.67, times its time, the time for the longitudinal. And at that point, you want to double check your equation right here. You want to make sure that the small speed has the bigger time. And the bigger time has the small, or the bigger speed has the smaller time, because these two things should be equal to each other. So double check. You want to make sure that you've got your relationships of the times correct before you go any farther with this. Once you make sure that you're okay, we're just going to do the math. Make sure that you multiply through the parentheses. So this is going to be 5.1 times our time, plus whatever 5.1 times 73 is. 5.1 times 73 gives me 372.3. So 372.3. And that's going to equal 8.67 times that unknown time. And then we're going to get our like terms together. So we're going to get our TLs together. So here's a term with TL in it. Here's a term with TL in it. I'm just going to subtract that 5.1 TL from both sides. So 8.67 minus 5.1 give me 3.57. So 3.57, you can do that in your head, TL is equal to 372.3. And then we want to figure out what that TL is. So we're going to divide both sides by that 3.57. So my 372.3 divided by 3.57. And I end up with 104.29. So 104.29. That's the amount of time. Let me in a second. That's the amount of time that it takes for the longitudinal wave to arrive. Be careful, however, you've got to realize you're not done yet. What you found at this point is the time. The question wants to know how far away was the earthquake. So to figure out how far away the earthquake was, we want to remember that distance is equal to speed times time. You just found the time for the longitudinal. So you've got the time for the longitudinal. You want to make sure that you're multiplying by the speed for the longitudinal. And the speed for the longitudinal one is the 8.67. So 8.67 kilometers per second, multiplying it by 104.29 seconds. And we're going to end up with a distance of, let's see, times 8.67. We get a distance of 904. Okay, we'll go ahead and put 0.2 on there. Just make sure we've got enough digits. And that's going to end up giving you the answers in kilometers. So that is the final answer to the question. Any questions?